So I guess what we wanted to dig into a little bit here is, how did we get here? How did we get from the world of package managed RHEL, package mode RHEL, to where we are today? There's sort of a history here, right? We went from the world where everybody was installing operating systems from physical media, and then, of course, USB sticks and whatever. I can remember that was the beginning of my career. That's how it was done. And then we had like Ghost. Remember when you used the image machines from Ghost or something? And then the whole space just sort of took off. And we just started year after year. There were these incremental improvements in how we can deploy operating systems, not just Linux, although that's what we're talking about today. But in general, like, how do I pixie boot a system? And then how, oh, Kickstart, that's really cool. Let's automate that. Let's build virtual machine images to use as templates, right? So yeah, I guess I'm rambling a bit there. So there were specifically some technologies that led into where we are now with image mode. And I think you have a little more insight into those than I do.
Yeah, part of it is that I was actually in some of the communities early, again, 10, 15 years ago when some of these first concepts came out, right? And it kind of ties into, people get confused because we're doing this with containers. Suddenly this is somehow containerized RHEL that is being run somehow. And it's really the OS image management, like that portion of what goes on the live host once it's installed, right? Because these are all for installing onto a virtual machine, onto a cloud, onto bare metal. Yes, bare metal, you can kickstart these things. So a lot of that comes out of, if you think back, and some of it's not even that far back, is, you know, the Atomic desktops and Fedora. That's where a lot of these things come from. We have CoreOS that sort of was very focused on being a container host, like Kinvolk and Flatcar and Project Atomic, all these things we did. Like, they were all very much in the early days of, oh, we need containers and we need Kubernetes, and we have these specialized hosts to build them. And that's where the first sort of, hey, it would be really cool if we didn't have to have fully managed standard operating system images.
Those were very purpose-built. They were almost designed to be a worker in a Kubernetes or an OpenShift cluster.
Exactly.
Right. They weren't general purpose RHEL.
Right. And I remember I was in Brno at DevConf CZ, and one of the I don't remember which of the maintainers of Project Atomic it was. Like, this is probably 2016, 2017 maybe, showed up with a desktop that he had been running with OS Tree, which was what we were running the container host node for Project Atomic on. And I was like, wait, what? You're running a desktop based on this stuff? And that was the start, basically, of Silverblue and all those things.
Cool.
But even then, right, that is still, like, there's a lot of Flatpak, and it's very purpose-built for desktops. Yeah,
Silverblue, I never switched to it. I thought it was neat, cool idea. No. But it never felt usable enough for me for the stuff I did on a desktop.
So the Bootc stuff, that is actually sort of logical successors to RPMO and things that came out of CoreOS, things that came out of Project Atomic that show up in other parts of our portfolio and in Silverblue and other things. The container stuff that we're talking about and why we can do these, like put things on GitHub, put things in GitForge, that is an improvement to how the images themselves were assembled and delivered, right? OS Tree has a very new, like, it built its own image format, and therefore it built its own way to actually build the things and then ship them via HTTPS, right? You just put them on a web server, and right, then you had to have specialized tools to do all that, which made it difficult and had other challenges. This takes all of that assembly process, uses the container file definition, the tooling that was already built to build fancy tarballs, right? Because that's all container is, right? It's a tarball, set of tarballs with some metadata, and they already have a distribution mechanism that tells you all sorts of things about what's inside of it. So really the container part of this, and why I don't use, like, we talk about Bootc images and Bootc in particular, and not a lot about what upstream calls bootable containers. And even this is from Colin, the lead developer, is like, bootable containers don't boot. Bootc unpacks them and turns them into a bootable thing.
Yeah, it's basically a transport for a disk image.
And
so the container itself, yeah, while it can start in a container runtime, which maybe we'll show in a little bit, it doesn't boot exactly. It runs right. like a container if you run it inside a container management system, or if you run it underneath yeah. a runtime like Podman or Docker. Actually, can you run them on Docker? I guess you could. The boot scene.
Yeah, because these are
I didn't want to misspeak there.
No, yeah. and that's kind of the drive, right? Is that the container file itself, the image that gets produced, the ways it gets sorted, these are all OCI standard things, which allows us to say, oh, well, okay, you have GitHub Actions. Can you run OCI stuff? Yes. Oh, you're using GitLab. Cool. Yeah. What if somebody in the audience is using Jenkins? No problem. Using OpenShift and want to use a Tekton pipeline? Cool deal. Ansible knows how to start and stop Podman things and run Podman commands. No problem. In fact, the very first version, my very first attempt to even prove this, I just used the off-the-shelf DockerX build actions out of GitHub, and those worked fine. It was complicated and I couldn't understand what was going on. So I started over. But the very first, like, can
it works,
I do
but
that?
I don't know why.
Yeah, exactly. Pretty much. But I bring it up because one, I like to enjoy, I like sharing failures. But two, like, it was literally, it's OCI standard stuff. I just grabbed something right. off the shelf, said, here's a container file, here's a registry. I was using right. the CentOS stream stuff, so I didn't have to worry about the credentials, but like, here's the registries. Can you build it? And I was like, yep, here you go. It's like, oh, this actually works. Like, this promise. This isn't just a promise of use any of these tool chains. It really means you now have access to any tool that knows how to do containers to build and drive your automation, right?
Right.